So I will start with a probably well-known picture to everyone. So this is a story of evolution stretched in time in the redshift. What is of most outmost interest after the Big Bang and the short inflation stage coming the dark ages when all ionized matter was again recombined, coming to the neutral state, and it was really dark in the universe. Shortly afterwards, something like 100 million years or maybe a little bit more, first stars start to appear and start to shine through the envelope from which they appear, accreting matter in the center of gravitation potential. And after first stars appears first protogalaxies, galaxies, and quasars, etc. And finally, we are now here at redshift zero at the age of 13.5 billion years of the universe. Reionization history, so the stage when the after inflation, after dark ages, matter started again to be reionized of the first stars, maybe first galaxies and first quasars, stretched from the redshift roughly 30, 25 or whatever, up to redshift of the order of 10. Precise numbers, of course, is still very questionable. There's some dispute about when it starts and when it's finished reionization. But probably this is better to say that it's task of the observers, of experimentalists, to define those points of this reionization epoch. Again, one has to underline, so probably the most interesting problem which is remained to be solved in the 21st century is to understand how this early universe developed in what we are now observing at redshift zero. This era was nicknamed by Roger Blandford like Cosmic Dawn. It's probably a very nice name. And this is the epoch when the first starlight from the first generation of stars again start to ionize the neutral matter, and the giving origin to the structure of the universe which is observed right now. Looking back, maybe one can state that definitely reionization finished was at the redshift 6, maybe at slightly higher redshifts. How to probe these stages of evolution, this epoch of reionization? One of the potential probes include quasars, galaxies, and gamma ray bursts. Normal galaxies nowadays are observed up to the redshift almost 10. And these observations are usually made through the photometric dropouts on the of the point-like source, which is maybe slightly extended in the observation filter. But these dropouts are not very reliable because they may be also produced by the dust extinction. Therefore, this object are not very suitable to probe early stages of evolution. Moreover, these galaxies most likely are the brightest end of luminosity distribution of the galaxies, and therefore this sample is not complete and biased. But still it's not very well observable by the existing instruments and maybe even the nearest instruments which are planned to be built. Probably the best probe which we can think today, this is gamma ray bursts. Quasars also quite luminous, but they drop rapidly after redshift Z6, which was claimed by the Fern. Don Lamb and Reichardt suggested that probably gamma ray bursts may be usable for the study in redshift starting from the few tens up to present epoch, with some help maybe for the lower redshift from quasars. Okay, GRB are very nice beasts. them are very bright. And just to underline maybe that quite recently appeared claims that some of them have isotropic luminosity or isotropic energy exceeding 10 in power 55, 57 ergs. So more than two orders of magnitude, which is quite well accepted nowadays by community. Those extremely bright probably are coming from the population three stars, so the first generation stars in the universe after dark ages. Those objects generally believed to be quite massive, having quite heavy envelopes, but recent studies by Suwa, Nyoka, and Nakagura et al. Claim that even massive envelope quite easily can be penetrated by the GRB jet. So it seems to me proof that those bright gamma ray bursts can be used in reality to probe redshifts, not only this from 6 to 8 or whatever, exceeding redshifts which are normally known for the largest distances quasars, but also to extend in the redshifts of few dozen units. This seems to be confirmed by some of the calculations by Vanderman and Piran, who suggested that this distribution may be quite well represents distribution of the gamma ray bursts in the redshift. So this is a number or probability to observe such redshifts from different redshifts. Of course, each instrumentation, which also can be seen on this slide, having their specific energy interval, their sensitivity, will observe much less number of high redshift gamma ray bursts. But this is instrumental limitation. Again, underlines that gamma ray bursts may be the best tool nowadays. This is distribution, which is historical development of redshift records. So recording different objects, galaxies, quasars, and gamma ray bursts, different redshifts depending on the year of observation. So 2011, the highest known redshifts belongs to the gamma ray bursts and to the normal galaxies. But as I said, normal galaxies is quite difficult to use for as a bright probes of the young universe, just because the sampling will be quite biased. Subsample of the those bright gamma ray bursts will be also quite usable for the cosmological studies. And this slide illustrates usability of long duration gamma ray bursts as distance indicators. This work, which was done by Tsutsui with colleagues in 2012, shows how one can use fundamental parameters of the gamma ray burst to add up those to the known Hubble diagram, which is built on the sample of supernova type 1a, and extend region of coverage of expanding universe to the redshift already exceeding 4. They also show how to derive constraint on the omega lambda and omega m from such exercise, and they derive quite reasonable numbers and a good fit for the values of cosmological interest. Another attitude is again to use long duration gamma ray bursts, which are expected to be produced by the massive stars and probably by population 3 gamma ray bursts. This is work of Liang Wun Zhang, published in 2010. They are using iteration method, again using some sample of the supernova of type A, adding to those some numbers of gamma ray bursts, and show that expansion of universe under assumption of the flat cosmological model of the flat universe can be extended already up to the redshift of 8. We can easily imagine if you will add up some more redshifts at this values of redshift up to 10 or maybe 20 even, who knows, one can really prove or disprove value of acceleration, which is observable now in the universe, and again prove or disprove, is it model of concordance, cosmological model, is correct one or not. This is again going along the line, just claiming that the gamma ray bursts are most probably promising probes for the high redshift universe, and for the redshift, especially exceeding value of 10, they are normally brighter by from 10 million to 100,000 than quasars, and not getting fainter beyond the redshift 3, just because the relativistic car correction there is not suppressing too much luminosity of those high redshift gamma ray bursts extending beyond redshift 3 or 6 or whatever. Limitations of the ground and space-based facilities, which are using optical wavelengths or infrared wavelengths, could not go beyond redshift Z of 13. And afterglow studies, even using wavelengths above or longer than 2.5 micrometers, are too faint by very many magnitudes, even for modern 8 to 10 meters telescopes on the ground. Therefore, the only way probably to go and study afterglow and prompt emission of the gamma ray bursts. And this slide, which is courtesy of Thomas Krüle, shows that afterglow studies are very good to study properties and of host galaxies of intergalactic matter up to maybe a redshift of 10. One can enjoy unique identification of the host galaxies, quite simple spectra derived by the photometry, for example, in different filters extending from the usually normally used UBV up to the K or maybe even longer wave lens. But the problem with these studies always are coming to mind, that all those studies of afterglows and of the gamma ray bursts which are causing those afterglows are very delayed relatively to the moment of explosion of the gamma ray burst. So this is extending from, let's say, minutes to tenths of the hours. And this is a limitation, because one probably need to have some indicator of the very high redshift gamma ray burst to start immediate follow-up observations, starting with maybe big telescopes on the ground, or maybe helping with the space instrumentation, which is available also. So up to now, SWIFT has found only 5 GRBs exceeding the with redshift exceeding a value of 6. This is just because of this limitation of long delay with follow-up observations after event itself. And this is again showing that these events at the redshift of exceeding values of 6, starting with spectroscopical observation 10 hours later, with photometry 41 hours later, again spectroscopy 10 hours later, spectroscopy 7 hours later, and photometry 2.5 hours later for the record redshift gamma ray burst at the redshift of 9.4. So this is an obstacle which have to be overcome if you are really serious in your intention to study this early epoch of evolution of the universe. One of the way out, which is close to my heart, this is of course to use a nuclear resonance absorption signature. But this is of course not the only one, and maybe not the best one. But we need to seriously study this possibility to give immediate warning to the follow-up observers that this particular long-duration gamma ray burst is a very high redshift. So GRB's slide beacons. This slide is taken from presentation of Jochen Greiner, who is also present here. And this is already well known that GRB follows the star formation rate. And moreover, quite recent publication by Elliot, Greiner, and their collaborators, they show that rate of gamma ray bursts linear or proportional to the star formation rate. Afterglows can be seen potentially up to the redshift 20, but as I said, shown in the previous slide, the afterglow to observe is also quite difficult task to realize that after maybe 10 hours or whatsoever, that this is gamma ray burst at high redshift, and one need to speed up a little bit this follow-up observations. 5 to 50%, and nowadays people are tending to say that above 5% of swift GRBs are observed at redshift exceeding value of 5. GRBs are ideal light beacons. Them are bright. Them are little affected by the dust extinction. Quite simple spectrum, power law or maybe power law with some break. There are usually no before GRB ionization of surrounding volume. And if you just can imagine that at this point, flash of GRB was observed, it will go through the reionization front and through the Lyman alpha clouds, galaxies, Lyman break galaxies, etc., to the observer. And in those galaxies, you can observe star formation or whatever. And this is quite rich information. This is another illustration of the same attitude. And such observations, which were done already in 2005 with this gamma ray burst, has shown that afterglow in the host galaxy of this gamma ray burst are very rich in metals. So immediate question was arising, how much metals were produced in this so early object at the redshift exceeding 6? This type of questions, of course, one need to follow. And again, the same argumentation. One can go through this afterglow observations, photometry or whatsoever, and near infrared band even. But even at those bands, you cannot exceed value of redshift 12, 14. So probably the best attitude to study and to probe early universe in gamma rays. So what we will have if you will take this approach? One might expect gamma ray burst happen to be produced by the first generation stars, so population 3 stars. They can be expected also from the quite fast galaxies. And in both cases, here we will learn about what are parameters of these objects, of these fast stars, and maybe of their immediate surrounding. In the host galaxies of the fast stars or proto-galaxies, one can study metallicity evolution starting from the early fast stars towards the smaller redshifts, towards the present age of the universe. How many of this high redshift gamma ray bursts one might expect? By using optically selected samples, Thomas Kruller and his collaborators have defined some values for the redshift distribution of high redshift gamma ray bursts. So about 5.5% expected for the redshift exceeding 5. And this was work by Jochen Greiner published in 2010. Perley et al. In 2009 have claimed that at the redshift exceeding 5, less than 14% of all gamma ray bursts might happen. And at the redshift exceeding 7, less than 7%. And all expectations are jumping up and down, basically around value about 5% for the gamma ray burst exceeding redshift 5. This value is also supported by the compilation of SDSS quasars. So only, this is quite different number. Only 0.05% of quasars is found as a redshift exceeding 5.7. So just speaking again, what kind of the probe one will select, quasars or gamma ray burst? Seems to be these numbers are completely in favor of using gamma ray burst as a potential probes of the early universe. This is supported also by the theoretical work of Richardson and Ellis, who has studied curve of integral distribution of the expected gamma ray bursts at different redshifts, comparing those with the star formation rate, etc. And it seems to me that the consensus is now coming to the claim that rate of long duration gamma ray bursts is linearly proportional to the rate of star formation. And this is work by Elliott, which is submitted and probably maybe already published in 2012. And if you look on the expected luminosity of those long duration gamma ray bursts, they are pretty bright, but of course not reaching those values which were claimed by the Komissarov and Barkov of 10 in power 55 or 57, but they are still pretty bright here. Now, what type of POP3 stars one can expect to detect? If you are really speaking about the very first stars, which are forming by accretion from the halo of the typical mass in 1,000 solar masses, the rate of such gamma ray bursts is quite low and probably not feasible to detect by SWIFT or by next mission, which we expect to be launched in 2014, or by projects like JANUS or EXIST. But the next generation, which are also first stars, but forming from the clumps of the matter with typical mass of 40, 60 solar masses, due to the influence of the previous objects of this, so some ionization already exists, some ionized clumps of the matter. So these objects are having already quite notable rate, and those are might be detectable by the this mission like SWIFT or some forthcoming mission like SWARM or some other future missions. Population 3 first generation stars are also quite interesting from the point of view of using this nuclear resonance absorption method, because those objects are forming from the halo, as I said, starting from maybe 1,000 solar masses or whatever, and they have very massive, very optically thick envelope. If you look at this distribution, which was calculated and published by Yoshida in 2006, one might expect such extreme values like about 10 in power 28 per square centimeter of matter of the hydrogen column per each decimal value in the astronomical unit. So this is a pretty heavily absorbed objects, but of course not everyone theoretician agree with these calculations and with these numbers. So we might expect much smaller numbers, but let's see what we will finally derive when we'll have suitable mission up there in the space. So a few words I want to say about this resonance gamma ray absorption method. In nuclear physics, three regions of energies are well known for their resonance properties. One is a so-called Pygmy resonance, which is typically belong to the energies of 7 MeV and might be produced by very many elements, so very many nuclei have this absorption capability around 7 MeV. Another one, which was very well studied quite early ages of development of the nuclear physics in the first publications is 1948 by Goldhaber and Taylor. This is so-called oscillation of the neutron fluid relatively to the proton fluid in the nuclei. Typical energy of this resonance, for example, exceeding from 15 MeV for heavy elements to 25 MeV for helium. And helium, it is most abundant element after hydrogen. So it is quite interesting to use this giant dipole resonance to measure resonance absorption from the first objects in the early universe. And the third one, resonance, this is so-called delta resonance, which is produced by the absorption of photons on all nuclei, starting from proton into the most heavy elements. This is 325 MeV. This is produced just by absorption on the nuclei with formation of so-called delta isobar, which is later on decays, producing some set of the P meson, including charge P meson and the neutral P meson, P0. And finally, leading to the removal of the photons with this energy from the incoming flux on the target. Generally speaking, the absorbing columns, so-called Nash columns, it's a very tricky business, which is studied by different methods, by optical, radio observations, by X-rays, etc. Curiously enough, all those observations, depending on what method or what molecules or atoms you are using, we will derive different distribution of absorbing column from the same objects. And this is quite interesting illustration. This is what was published by Hopkins in 2006. Distribution of absorbers on the line of sight, if you will observe them optically, and if you will observe them in X-rays. So it's quite notable difference of the peak value of absorbing column. In gamma, our first publication shows that we have observed from the number of quasars of flaring objects, of the quasars in flaring state, even higher columns, and I'm not surprised, but still people are not easily following a simple, maybe, argument that absorbing columns that you observe at different wavelengths, long wavelengths, shorter long wavelengths, and even shorter long wavelengths have tendency to show higher values the shorter wavelengths prop those absorbing columns you are using. For observed gamma ray bursts, there also exists very nice distribution, some very nice measurements were made by Thomas Krule and his collaborators, and it's published. And you see that for maybe some of the high redshift gamma ray bursts, columns are observed already as high as 10 in power 23. Okay, this is just some cross-section of nuclear resonance absorption processes. I will not invest too much time in explaining those, but I just want to show what one can do with the spectral energy distribution of flaring object. Here on this slide, I show the so-called normalized ratio of spectral energy distribution of flaring object to the simple power law or broken power law, which is used to extrapolate spectrum of this 3C279 quasar from 100 keV up to 1000 MeV or 10,000 MeV. And you can see that in flaring states, some prominent absorption feature appear at the energy which is slightly exceeding 100 MeV. And if you take into consideration the redshift of the object, the value of position of the energy of this absorption comparing with 325 MeV gives you exactly the redshift of the quasar 3C279. Less significant just because the huge error bars measured for the energies lower than 30 MeV by COMTEL and by OSI here, just do not provide much constraint on the giant dipole resonance region, but it's still, broadly speaking, consistent with the presence of such an absorption.
So why is the resonance having the 325 resonance have a shoulder?
Just shoulder is produced by so-called absorption in the universe at the redshift zero. There is some contribution expected.
Just absorption on the photon on the way here.
Yeah. Exactly. Or this is maybe some so-called warm intergalactic absorber or whatever. So this needs to be investigated. Having in mind those methods, how you can really, first of all, maybe detect gamma ray bursts from the extreme redshift faster generation stars, and to use those spectra to apply nuclear resonance absorption method, the energy range for the potential instrument which can be flown in the next decade maybe, have to be extended from the 1 MeV to 70 MeV to well cover the redshift range we are interested in. So let's say from the redshift of 10 up to maybe 20. But, of course, one would like to measure with such instrument, with such mission, also polarization. And polarization is measured if you have energy coverage from 10 keV to 1 MeV, the best known method, which is already proved by measurements of integral of polarization from Crab Nebula and of EBIS measurements for polarization of one of the gamma ray bursts. Maybe it will be better explained and shown in the talk of the Laurent. You need to shift energy range even to the low energies, to 10 keV to 1 MeV. And if you consider the typical peak energy of the gamma ray burst and take into consideration the redshift of this distribution, so you need really to move to as low energies as 1 keV. So one would like probably to follow the route which was proposed by the GRIPS mission. And this is a slide from the proposal which was submitted by Johan Greiner and the GRIPS collaboration. And in their proposal, the suggestion was that gamma ray monitor will cover energies to some extent from few hundred keV, am I right, Johan? Maybe 200? 200, okay. And then to augment this gamma ray monitor by X-ray monitor to cover the lower energy range to pick up high redshift gamma ray bursts. And of course, would be nice to have some kind of infrared or optical monitor helping to find precise coordinates to make easier follow-up observations by ground instrumentation or by some other space instrumentation. Okay, this is something about polarization. The plot which is demonstrated by Lazzati in his paper of 2006 just shows that polarization from a completely aligned magnetic field can be quite well measured if you have even spectral indexes so steep as a value of 4. But I will not go into much detail because special talk will be dedicated to this problem. Of course, to use gamma ray bursts, one also to solve on the way some problems. One of the problems, this is the role of magnetic fields in the central engine or in the region of internal shock or external shocks which are producing gamma ray emission. And this can be helped only by the measurement of polarimetry of polarization from such objects. It's not well understood up to now long-term activity of the central engine of the gamma ray burst. Some ideas are around, but this is better to be solved by theoreticians before we make a commitment and select some specific energy range for the instrumentation. And moreover, there's some expectation on the microphysical processes might be changing at such extremely high redshifts in objects which typically gamma ray burst producing fast stars, which are very massive, and some fine-tuning of microphysics may be well needed. Conclusions which I draw from all this. So GRB cosmology holds tremendous promise. Probably no one in this auditorium will argue against this. The ideal signposts of the fast stars and the fast galaxies. They may be suitable also because their frequency or their rate are factor 100 higher than the rate or expectation to observe quasars at such extreme high redshifts. GRBs are also usable as props of the early intergalactic metametallicity of the dust and of the host galaxy properties. Missions capable of detecting such high redshift GRBs are vitally important to advance GRB cosmology of the early universe to the maturity. And I stop at this slide. Thank you very much. Okay.